If you use the grind, I need to talk to you about the flyout after the meeting.
Say again?
I need to talk to you about the flyout after the meeting.
So we may have to do it before the end of the meeting. I've got to pick up somebody.
Okay. Yeah, we'll just go out.
Yeah. That's fine.
Well, it's 7 o'clock. We're going to get started. Those that are out in the waiting room, come on in. If you want to come in. Well, welcome everybody. We have about 30 people online and about a dozen people in the room here. So it's a great turnout. I expect a few more. So thanks for joining us, getting down the heat for a few minutes to learn about mountain flying. So I'm Nathan Whitaker, and I'm the president of Desert Flying Club. We have these monthly safety meetings, and it's nice that last month was our first hybrid meeting that we had some people online and some people in the room here. So I think it turned out pretty good. I'd like to welcome everybody that's online too to the meeting. Hopefully you can hear me okay. If you can, I'll be moderating it once Josh starts. So just put in the chat if you guys have any issues hearing me or Josh, and I'll make sure to correct those as we go along. So again, just a few announcements about the club and what's going on. And I will obviously stick around after the fact. Mark and I are both on the board and we can talk about the club and answer any questions, but we do have some things that happened over the last month. We have a new aircraft online. We have 182, 344 Romeo, 3444 Romeo, I think is the call sign. So we're excited about that. It's a great plane. The owners are looking to do some avionics upgrades on it too, but it is IFR, great flying plane. I know that's one of the ones that the club members said that they really wanted the club, and we've been working diligently to find it. A great 182 to put in the club. Also, the Comanche 250, we've reduced some checkout requirements on that. So if you are checked out on the Comanche 180, getting into the 250 will be much easier. So a great option to kind of step up into a higher performance airplane, doing some of those cross-country flights. And then, of course, the sim. A lot of you have been checked out in the sim, the new Redbird sim that we have. It's a brand new, hot off the press, Redbird LD. It's got the six pack on a 172 plus 530, 430, and an autopilot. So it's a great IFR platform. And it's an AATD, which is, if anybody's looking to get their instrument rating, you can use 20 hours towards your instrument rating for that. So it's a great addition to the club. And if you're interested in that a little bit more, feel free to throw it in the chat for those that are online, or stick around and ask any questions after the fact. We are doing a flyout. I think it's pretty full at this point, but we're doing our first flyout in the last 2 years. So Jan has been putting that together. We're going to go up to Mesquite on the 26th and have kind of a brunch at the casino there. I don't know, how many, 8 to 10 that have signed up or more?
I don't know, it's probably closer to 15.
15 now that have signed up. So it'd be a great group going up, and appreciate, I think like more than about 2/3 of our fleet are going up there at this point. So
looks like,
yeah, which is pretty exciting. I think that's it for the announcements. Did I miss anything from an announcement standpoint? Other than it's hot out there, you know, make sure, you know, we had a, Gary gave a great presentation last month about density altitude, definitely something to consider. And also the function of the high temperatures on the planes. You know, it's a big consideration right now to make sure that you're getting most of your flying done early in the morning before it gets pretty hot outside, because the heat could be really detrimental on the aircraft if you guys are flying when it's not just on us, but on, I guess if you want to lose a few pounds, go sit in the aircraft for a few minutes on the ground, at least in water weight very quick there. But anyways, without further ado, we're really excited. Josh Harkness has been one of our CFIs for almost two years. Unfortunately, we're going to be losing him here real soon, but we appreciate him giving this talk this afternoon or this evening about mountain flying, and excited to hear about that. So I'll turn it over to Josh.
All right, thanks, Nathan. I'm Josh Harkness. I've been here for a couple of years now, teaching, instructing with CFI, so most of this is all the initial stuff. But yeah, I'm getting excited. I just got an offer for SkyWest. So I'm going to be leaving here in the next months, starting that journey. So, so today we're going to talk a little bit about mountain flying. Anybody know where the FAA defines mountainous terrain? Anybody? So it's basically anywhere west of the Rocky Mountains, right? Essentially, there is also another pocket down in the southeast as well, along those mountains as well. But pretty much everything that we have here in Nevada is considered mountainous terrain according to the FAA, okay? So if you've flown around here, then you've technically done some mountain flying according to the FAA. But we're gonna get to dive a little deeper into mountain flying, some of the awesome opportunities that there are around here to fly around in the mountains and do some different sightseeing and stuff like that. And some of the different precautions and considerations that you really should take when planning a flight around the mountains and flying around mountain terrain. I'm no expert on mountain flying per se. I've been flying around here for a few years now and have a bunch of hours. So I'd say I have some experience, but I wouldn't necessarily say I'm an expert at mountain flying. So if any of you guys have any comments, considerations, please feel free to ask or anything like that. And so I don't know everything, but I'll do my best. I know last month Gary talked a lot about density altitude. Part of mountain flying is also density altitude, so you're gonna get a little bit of a refresh on what he talked about.
Josh, could you just speak up just slightly?
Yeah. I would. Hang on a second. This is for some reason it jumped ahead on me. I don't know why. Skipped around here. Okay, cool. Get back here. All right. So density altitude. Density altitude is definition is pressure altitude that's been corrected for non-standard temperature. Okay. So the other definition kind of is basically just how the airplane feels, right? Like what it feels like. How is it performing? Does it feel when you're flying out of here at 2,500 feet, the airplane might feel like it's already flying at 5,000 feet. You're trying to take off from 5,000 feet, but you're really taking off at 2,500 feet. Okay, that's kind of how to explain what density altitude is. So how do you calculate density altitude? There's a few ways of calculating density altitude. You can grab one of these fancy density altitude charts that you might have seen before. And be able to calculate it that way. Another way is using your handy dandy E6B that I know all of you guys have and use every day. You can use that as well, or you can just do the math if you like math and figure out the calculation. So basically to figure it out, it's density altitude is equal to whatever pressure altitude is. And then you add it by the outside air temperature minus by the standard temperature and then times it by 120. And then add that to pressure. That's how you get density. Okay. A lot of math to figure out, so I'm all about using either the charts or going to four flight. That's usually the easiest way of doing it. So, but always, you should always look at what the density altitude is before you go fly. It's really important. Know what it's going to feel like, especially this last week. It's been brutal. The density altitude's been really high. The airplanes have really been sluggish. And so it's really important to figure out density altitude before you go. It's really important to always run the numbers on density altitude. So you want to look at your charts. I know we're so used to our EFBs and four flight and all these fancy gadgets, but we really need to get back into the POH when we're talking about calculating our density altitude, calculating our performance takeoffs and landings. They're really critical. I have a picture here of, I believe that's takeoff performance here. There is the little caveat up here. Those are really important to read those. They talk about how you should calculate based on wind, headwinds, and tailwinds. If you're taking off of a dirt strip or it's assuming that it's a dry strip. It also assumes that you're going to take off with a short field takeoff, right? And so using all the techniques as a short field takeoff. If you don't use those techniques, well, your ground roll is going to be longer. It's going to take you longer to put a 50-foot obstacle, right? One thing that's really important to mention is if we zoom in here on this calculation, is if you think, let's say on a really hot day where it's 30 or 40 degrees outside, and you calculate your density altitude, or you figure your pressure altitude, and let's say you have a 3,000 foot strip or so that you're taking off of. So you look at this, it's 30 or 40 degrees outside, okay? You look at this, it's really easy to assume that, hey, at a 3,000 foot runway, I should be off. I should be able to not only be off, but clear a 50 foot obstacle by halfway, right? That's pretty good, right? What you really need to think about though, is that that's only 50 feet at halfway, right? So what about the other half of the runway? You can kind of just take that, you're going to put a 50-foot obstacle at halfway, assume that you're only maybe going to be 100 feet off the ground by the end of the run. It's not very high, right? If there's obstacles, if there's something there, right, then you might not want to do that. Might be something to consider. Also, it's assuming that you are going to maintain this airspeed as well at 62 knots in this example, right? Typically, we want to try and gain a little bit extra speed and not climb out of that speed. So it doesn't account for that either. So you may be at 50 feet and you may be trying to gain some extra airspeed, which is going to take more runway, right? And so kind of see where I'm getting now. If you, I don't know if a lot of you have a lot of experience taking off of a high density altitude airport, but if you have, you can definitely tell the difference, right? It's also assumed that you are leaned out properly, leaned out at best power. Gary did a good discussion about how to lean properly before takeoff and in the air. And so this is assuming that you've done that as well. Any decrease in performance because you didn't lean out properly is going to also take this into consideration. So it's really important that you just don't look at these numbers alone. You need to reference your performance charts, your climb charts, these things, to really understand how you're going to perform overall. Another consideration too is the runway, okay? Does it slope? Is there a sloping runway, okay? In the mountainous terrain, we have a lot of runways that slope. Even here at Henderson, look at the charts. It's 1.8, I believe, degrees slope right here at Henderson, which you may not think is that big of a deal, but the general rule is that at 1 degree of slope, it can increase your ground roll by as much as 22%, which is a lot, okay? Now, granted, you take into other considerations, you take into a headwind, that's going to decrease that some. You're going to take into, other things like that. That could decrease your ground roll, all right? But you really want to consider if the runway slopes, that's something that you definitely need to take into consideration, okay? Some people may argue that if you have a light tailwind, that maybe it might be better to take off downhill still. That's really debatable. In most general aviation airplanes, you're still probably better off, if you crunch the numbers, you're still probably better off taking into a headwind versus rolling downhill. So a downhill only will decrease your ground roll by 7% per 1 degree of slope, okay? And a tailwind, if you look at the calculations on a tailwind, it increases only a 4-knot tailwind increases like by 10 or 12%. So more than likely, you're still better off taking off uphill, but it's still definitely something to consider in your ground roll. So that's the altitude for us. Come over to the next one. We're talking about wind and weather. So this is really critical in calculating when you're flying around mountains, is to know what your winds aloft are. Okay. Sometimes it's easy to be really complacent when you're flying around here, not to look at your winds aloft, but you really should be looking at them. Know what altitude you're going to be at, what the winds and temperatures are, and how that's going to affect your performance overall. So talking about wind, when you are going to fly around the mountains and around valleys and around ridges, typically speaking, you always want to be on the windward side versus the leeward side. Okay, the windward side is the side where the prevailing winds are coming from. Typically in the United States, if you look at a topographical map, most ridges run north and south, and most of the prevailing winds come from the west. So typically speaking, you want to be on the west side of any ridge. Generally speaking, of course, there's always a caveat to that, but that's a kind of a general rule. Windward side is always going to give you more lift. It's always going to bring the winds. You're always going to be able to have any updrafts. Okay. And if you're flying close to mountains, updrafts are typically better than downdrafts. So you always want to try and stay on the windward side versus the leeward side. When you do decide to approach a ridge on the leeward side, you always want to give yourself some extra room when flying over a ridge. So the general rule is for every 10 knots of wind, you should be 1,000 feet above terrain, okay? And so that's kind of just a general rule. Because you could potentially experience some downdrafts on the leeward side as you approach. Another important rule, thing to consider is you always should cross the ridge on a 45 degree angle, especially on the leeward, coming from the leeward side towards the windward side. That's really important because that's where you're gonna get downdrafts typically. It's not that if you can't encounter it at a 90 degree angle and straight on, it's not that you can't get away from it, because you can. But you have to consider also, if you hit turbulence, the reason that you're going to turn away is because you've hit turbulence probably, right? You've encountered a downdraft. So the tighter you make that turn, the more you're going to pull back, to try and not lose altitude, the more load you're putting on the airplane, and load factor, stall speed goes up, all that stuff, right? So to approach it at 45 is always better than approaching it at a 90 degree. Sometimes if you're gonna approach multiple ridges at a time, you may wanna zigzag. You may wanna approach 45 to the north and then 45 to the south and so on to remain on course. But those are, that's important to consider. One that we probably all heard of is mountain wave activity. Mountain wave happens all the time here. I've seen lenticular clouds all the time. That's kind of the big weather phenomenon around mountain waves is the lenticular clouds. Those are formed because air is being pushed up on the windward side, right? As that air gets pushed up, if it's moist air, then as it gets up and it cools, then it's going to form a lenticular cloud. It gets lenticular because that air is constantly moving through it. It's not stationary air, so it kind of has a wispy kind of look to it, the lenticular cloud. And so generally speaking, you see those clouds, it's a good idea to stay away because there probably is mountain wave activity. Mountain wave activity generally starts occurring about 20 to 25 knots winds aloft. If it's smooth and if it's not very strong wind, a lot of times it'll stay laminar on the windward side, and they'll come right down on the leeward side. And it may not be super turbulent, but you are going to get some updrafts and downdrafts for sure. And so those are things to consider. If you are going to cross over a ridge when there's mountain wave activity, you definitely want to be ready for any updrafts and downdrafts, because you will get them for sure. If it becomes very heavy winds and very high winds and gusty winds, then you can get like the middle example here, and that's going to be the breaking waves and the rotor turbulence. And this is where it can be very dangerous, where mountain waves can get really ugly, is when the, you get rotor turbulence and rotor waves. It's basically because the wind is just so prevalent that it starts breaking up. And just like on our wings, for example, when we get into a stall, right, that's that turbulence, the laminar flow is no longer stuck to the wing. It gets turbulent. And it's kind of the same thing where the wind's coming up on the westward, the windward side, right? But it can no longer be laminar because it's moving too fast or the flow isn't right. And so it breaks off and becomes turbulent. And so this has been known. I was looking at some accidents and stuff like that from mountain wave activity. It's ripped off engines on jetliners before. It's ripped off tails of Navy planes before. It can be very violent and very turbulent. They can also be very high. They can also get up into the flight levels, mountain waves. And so I was talking to my father-in-law about this, and he experienced mountain waves coming over the Rockies. He was in around 36,000 feet or so. I don't know exactly what altitude he was, but he said he was coming over the Rockies once and went full power to try and outclimb some mountain wave activity, and he could not climb it. So he just had to tell ATC that he couldn't maintain altitude and needed to block altitude. Mental flight at 737 was taking off at Denver International, and all of a sudden got a 45 knot gust of wind out of nowhere, lost control, went into the dirt and crashed. The airplane caught on fire. Everybody was able to evacuate, but they were trying to figure out why he lost control on the ground. Like, what caused this? The winds were like 27 sustained, and all of a sudden we got a 45 knot gust, which wasn't anticipated. It wasn't forecasted. And they're trying to figure out why, and they actually found out that it's because of mountain wave activity that he lost control, right? So the wind coming up off the Rockies and coming down into the valley to the plains actually caused him to go off the runway and experience a loss of control. So I think even today, where you really don't fully understand mountain wave activity, I think it's still something that we're still trying to figure out exactly how it all works. Because sometimes it's very smooth air, other times it's very turbulent. Sometimes it's happening and sometimes it's not. And so I think we're still trying to figure it out. But the effects of mountain wave is that it will come up a ridge, start coming down the other side. As you can see in the picture here, the flow continues, right? And it's been known, they've actually seen it continue on for 500 miles past the Rocky Mountains, where it's just oscillating the wind. Just like a wave, basically, right? It's just continuing to oscillate up and down, up and down, up and down for miles and miles and miles. So just because you're not even no flying over mountains, you could experience mountains.
Hey, Josh, there's a question online, and if you could repeat this, I'll take care of it. Somebody asked, or David asked, what velocity winds are typically associated with rotors and braking waves?
There wasn't anything very specific. It just says that when they become a lot higher winds is basically all it said. So there was no like specific wind when they started breaking, but as far as when it typically mountain wave in general starts to occur is about 20 to 25 knots it can start. And that doesn't mean that you're always gonna get it. Just because there's 25 knot winds doesn't mean there's always gonna be mountain wave activity either. Could just be coming over the ridge and could be fine. So there's no guarantee that mountain wave is happening just because the winds are high. So it's kind of a weird phenomenon that we, again, still don't necessarily fully understand. So, talk about these. Cool. So, VFR, IFR in mountainous terrain. Well, we all fly, generally speaking, we talk about general aviation aircraft. And for most general aviation aircraft in mountainous terrain, to fly IFR, typically the MEAs are just way too high. Around here, if you're trying to fly like towards Utah, typically they're anywhere between 14,000, 13,000 feet. I mean, it's pretty tough for us general aviation little airplanes to get up there to fly the MEAs. And then also a lot of times when you're looking at departure procedures, flying IFR, a lot of times the climb gradients that you need to accomplish in order to clear terrain and clear obstacles is also pretty high as well. Okay. That is another thing to consider as well that I think I forgot to talk about before, is it's important too when you're talking about your climb out and how your climb performance is going to affect you to convert your feet per minute into feet per nautical mile. And that can be a really important thing. So you can understand really how, if you're going to be able to really clear terrain, you know, if that climb is going to be sufficient or do you have to go around terrain. In IFR, we typically try and reverse it, right? We take our feet per nautical mile because that's what they put the all your departure procedures and stuff like that as feet per nautical mile. We usually typically convert that to feet per minute, so that way we can get a reading in the airplane and know what to fly. But when you're considering trying to clear obstacles, it's always good to put it in back to feet per nautical mile so you can really understand if you can even clear the terrain or not based on your calculations and your performance calculations. They won't. It's just on the departure procedure. So, like when you're flying IFR, if you read your departure, then it's going to tell you what you need to maintain. So that's part of the procedure. Sometimes you'll hear them here.
Could you repeat that question?
Oh, so he asked if will they give you an assigned feet per nautical mile to fly before you take off, right? Is that basically what you asked?
Yeah, because say climb 500 feet a minute, let's say. But I never got a clearance like that, but they said you need to go over a nautical mile.
Yeah.
It's usually posted on the departure.
Right.
I've also heard them give a IFR clearance here at Henderson, and then after they get the clearance and it's read back, they will then ask the pilot to please verify that clearance will get him over all subsequent terrain. So they're not giving you information, they're expecting you to know.
That's honestly that because they don't have to.
Yeah,
it is good to do it, but
they'll do it here.
Their expectations are yes.
Josh, for those that are online, if you could repeat about the departure clearance on IFR.
Right. So basically, when you're IFR and you want to fly a departure procedure, which you don't have to, you can actually decline a departure procedure as well. But if you do fly a departure procedure, you're going to find on there feet per nautical mile, and so ATC isn't going to give that to you. They're just going to expect you that you went and looked at the chart for the departure procedure and that you know your own performance and that you're going to fly that minimum requirement of that feet per nautical mile. So that's just what's expected of you. They don't actually assign that. Here at Henderson, they do ask you most of the time. They'll ask the IFR pilots if their clearance complies with any terrain requirements and obstruction requirements. And like you said, it's kind of like just them being nice. It's assuming that you've done your homework and you've gone and actually done your flight plan and that you can actually meet those requirements. You should be able to. So that pretty much answers your question. They don't actually give you an assigned climb rate or anything like that on departure. They just assume that you'll fly those departure procedures. Again, you don't have to take a departure procedure. They're not required. They help manage the flow of traffic a little better, but you don't have to take a departure procedure. They're not required. But yeah, for us,
IFR pilot is assuming that the IFR clearance center tower is responsible for the terrain clearance collision avoidance. That's what you're hoping that they're watching you and they're watching you.
Yeah, but ultimately it's like you're the pilot in command and you should have, you know, you gotta do your calculations and know that departure procedure, if that's what you want to fly, that you can meet those basic, you know, requirements of those feet, that feet per minute, right? To outclimb any terrain or anything like that. So a lot of times we're flying VFR here, at least initially, a lot of times, so we can get out and get away. Sometimes it's kind of hard for our general aviation to fly IFR here because we can't meet the MEAs. And sometimes we can't meet that climb gradient. Another important consideration too is pressure and temperature. Okay. Remember the high to low, look out below, right? So this is common for pressure and for temperature as well. Okay. If it's a cold day, you're going to be lower than you think you are. If it's a low pressure day, again, the same thing, right? You're gonna be lower than you think you are. So high to low, look out below. Another thing to consider when you're flying around mountains, and kind of apply this to mountain flying, is if it's windy over a mountain ridge, right? We all know our favorite man, Bernoulli, right? Who helped us realize what flying meant, right? So Bernoulli's principle applies the same way. When wind is coming over a mountain ridge, it's moving faster, right, typically, than when it was before it started moving over the ridge, which creates a low pressure. So that low pressure going over your static port is going to read lower than you really are, right? It's going to think that your indicated is going to be lower than what you're actually flying. Okay? This is important, too, to consider that Bernoulli is kind of working it against you sometimes when you're flying, especially over a ridge, that momentarily as you fly over that ridge and that air is moving a little bit faster, it's creating a low pressure. And that low pressure is going to think that you're flying a little bit lower than you really are. So for terrain avoidance, typically, especially, you know, VFR, there's a couple tricks that you can use to make sure that you're clearing terrain, right? And that's visually look. If you can see over it, if you can see over the ridge or a peak, then typically you can clear, right, is the general rule. If you see over it and that picture over the ridge is getting bigger in your sight picture, if you can kind of visualize that with me, if it's getting bigger and you can see more and more over the ridge, then you know you can clear that obstacle. If that starting to decrease, okay, visually over the ridge, you're looking and what you can see over the ridge is decreasing, you're not going to make it over. That's kind of a general rule. Don't sit there and focus on that, obviously. Keep flying the airplane and looking outside and seeing a void. But that's kind of a general rule that I like to try and teach, is that if you can see over it, you can clear it. And as long as that's getting bigger, what you can see over the ridge is getting larger in your windscreen, you're going to clear the terrain. Okay. Also, make sure you know the difference between true altitude and indicated altitude and pressure altitudes. Right. True altitude is what those ridges are at. Those have been verified. They've gone up there and said, yep, this peak is at 5,000 feet. MSL, right? Just because we're indicating 5,000 feet MSL, because we got the weather at Henderson and we've flown 15 miles away to a peak or a ridge, doesn't mean that we are going to clear that ridge, that peak, right? So important to consider the difference between true altitude and indicated altitude. And what you actually are. This is why it's really important to always get an updated altimeter setting as often as you possibly can. I know flying around mountainous terrain, sometimes those are farther and farther and farther apart. Might not be until the other valley or two valleys away till you can get weather. So just really make sure you have a buffer of that you're comfortable with flying over terrain when you haven't gotten an updated altimeter setting. Okay.
Hey Josh, there's a question online from James. How do you decline a departure procedure if you're being IMC on departure?
That's a really good question. Good thing I'm not a double I. So I, as far as I know, it's not required, right?
Departure. You're going up in hard line of bar.
Yeah.
There's no way, you have no course guidance, you have to apply departure procedure.
Sure.
Unless you do a visual climb over the airport, for that, you need to see the airport. So if you're taking off into 00, you would have to apply departure procedure or something.
Yeah.
Or vectors, right? You could request vectors.
Sure. You can get radar vectors.
Exactly. I'm gonna say you should decline a departure procedure, but I think you can, as far as I know, you can decline a departure procedure, but you would need some sort of guidance on your own then, to fly an AVAID or initial vector, say on departure fly whatever heading they want you to fly and get a vector.
For all of our planes, so the DP departure procedures, they all specify turbojet aircraft only.
Right.
So that kind of keeps us, we're not flying those DPs, but there is an ODP, an obstacle departure, that gives a textual description of how to take off and what to do, fly this far, turn right heading this, intercept folder, so-and-so radial. But they will also have climb gradients, just like you were talking about, fly with.
Sure.
So you have to look at your how many feet per minute can you fly in the Cessna 172 and what's your ground speed and then you can fly with that. Mm-hmm. But yeah, if you're taking off 00, you've got to have some course. You got to have an ODP or a DP.
Gotcha. So yeah, basically, like you said, you have to have, if you're taking off 00, then you have to have some sort of departure procedure or just some way of navigating in general or an obstacle departure procedure of some kind. So I hope that answers your question. So other considerations is at night. I'm not a huge fan of flying at night, especially single engine over mountainous terrain. I'm a CFI, so I have to do it in order to teach my students, but doesn't mean I necessarily love it. So, there's just a lot of things to consider when you're flying at night, going cross country over mountainous terrain, there's been a lot of accidents that I've read about and I've seen and I've heard that happened at night due to control flight into terrain. And so really and truly at night, especially here, if you're not flying just like over the city, you're going to be like on a cross country, you should really treat it basically like IFR. You should really be even one of the two IFRs, right? You can actually treat it like IFR and mostly fly your instruments and be treating it like IFR conditions somewhat as much as you can. Obviously, you still need to be able to look outside and find what you can and what you can see. Problem with that, though, is you can get false horizons. If there's lights on a hillside, something like that, you may think that that's a horizon, but it's really not. So that's kind of the bad thing about flying at night. Especially over mountainous terrain. You should always try and fly higher than the mean elevation figure, which is on all your VFR charts. It's the big number right in the middle of the quadrants, right? If you can fly over those, then you should not hit any terrain, right? Theoretically. And so always try, if you can, to fly above those altitudes, because that's going to give you the most protection possible from the terrain. Use all your resources that you have available. Use an electronic flight bag. Use the AHARS that's provided. Use ForeFlight, depending on what subscription you have. It gives you an artificial horizon in there. Obviously, don't fly primary off of it, but use it as a visual reference. If you have synthetic vision of some kind that gives you terrain awareness, those are always good. The fear is always controlled flight to terrain. You're flying in mountainous terrain, at night, is that you just sometimes you just never know where that it's going to be. There's been so many accidents that I can think of. There's been a King Air that I remember hearing about that was flying at night, I think in southern Utah, that crashed, flew right to a mountain. One here a couple years ago, a former air traffic controller crashed a Cirrus into the mountain a couple years ago, which is really sad. And so always, that's another thing too, is always trust but verify as well. Air traffic control, they're great. They do awesome service. They provide a great service, but they're also human beings too. So always trust, but also verify that they're giving you a good vector. If it seems weird that they're vectoring you somewhere, or maybe they might be wrong, question it, query it. You know, it's, you're still PIC, you're still in control of that airplane. And so you need to make sure that you're not gonna fly into something, right? Take control of that airplane, it's yours. Make sure you're not going to hit something. That's another good point is don't be afraid to question something. You know, air traffic controllers are great. They provide an awesome service. That's what I was going to do initially when I started my career in aviation. That's kind of what I was going for. I love air traffic control. It's great. But always trust but verify. Anytime, for anything, make sure that you're doing the right thing and that you are controlling that airplane and that you're being safe. So it's up to you. Another consideration is canyon flying. I don't know if anybody here has done a lot of canyon flying. I haven't done very much canyon flying. If you are gonna do it, there are some things to always try and do and to do it safely. Biggest thing I would say is if you are going to fly down a canyon is to fly over it first to make sure there's no wires, no obstructions, no nothing, that there's always a way out, right? If you are going to fly down a canyon, you fly into a box canyon, that's going to be really trouble, especially if you can't turn around. So if you are going to go through and do any canyon flying, do a flyover first and become familiar with it, okay? And then always have an out, I think is one of the most important things, right? Whether it's knowing that a canyon leads to an out before you actually fly it, or whether you can out climb the terrain, right? In case you do encounter a box canyon, make sure that you have the performance and the ability to get out of that situation. Try and always stay on the windward side when possible. That's gonna, again, so you don't get a downdraft. You know, you always want to have the better side of caution and always have a potential updraft versus a downdraft. But typically speaking, like the common courtesy is to always try and fly on the right side of the canyon. If there's somebody else maybe flying in the canyon or something like that, common courtesy would tell you to stay on the right side of it. But that's, you know, there's a lot of other things that play into that too. So I would say the windward side would be more important than staying necessarily on the right side of the canyon if it was the leeward side. So, and then really watch your speed. Speed is everything when you want to turn around, okay? So if you find yourself in a position where you need to turn around because it is a box canyon and there is no other way out, then slow down, right? Remember, if you slow down, it slows the radius the radius of your turn, right? If you are flying in there really fast and you try and turn, you're going to have a much bigger and wider turn and wider radius. You may not be able to make the, they call it the canyon, box canyon turn, right? And so make sure you're slowing down and so that way you can make that turn with a smaller radius, you know, however you have to. And anybody got any questions?
I'm gonna go back to that. I'm not sure I heard you. The forward element, leaning the engine before takeoff roll?
Yes, absolutely. Okay. Yeah. So, Lycoming, Gary did a really good presentation on that last month. If you look at the Lycoming and what they tell you, you should really do a full power run up on a really hot day. Like, if you're going to go, but it has to be fast. You can't just sit there at full power because you're going to burn up your cylinders, right? And so the key is if you are going to, you should lean out on before takeoff. Like Homing says, you run up the engine to full power, lean it out till you get a drop, and then back in and get the best power, and then bring it back out to idle, right? It should be about no more than five seconds is what, like Homing, I think, recommends. So you got to do it pretty quick because you could burn up a cylinder. It's not good to run the engine on the ground at high RPMs in the heat because there's just not a lot of airflow going over the cylinders, and you can easily burn up a cylinder having it full power for very long. So that's the way like Homing recommends. I know there's other ways, of doing it. Some people try and lean it out while during their run-up at 1,700 RPMs or wherever you do your run-up at. And you can do that, but it's still kind of a guess, like if you have it set really for best power or not, right? You're kind of assuming that you're close. And you can maybe have it too lean or too rich and not really be at best power on takeoff. So, for high density altitude operations, everything is based on that. The performance charts are all based on whether or not you leaned prior to takeoff and you're actually producing best power. Anything less than best power, you're not going to hit those numbers. And so it's reduced performance.
What's a good rule of thumb for density altitude to start and then lean before takeoff?
What is a good recommendation? What do you do, Mason?
I believe the club is 3,000 feet, right? We don't want anyone. I would lean the eye below that. Well, it's really what.
So basically what they
say, you should definitely lean on every tank. You're lean it out on every takeoff.
Yeah, so like Homing recommends about 5,000 feet we need to start a density altitude, we need to lean out. So like Gary was saying, pretty much from here until the end of summer, it's a 5,000, we should treat it like a 5,000 foot airport because that's pretty much what it is. And so we should be leaning before takeoff every time, at least until the winter time. And then, you know, as you climb out, once you get, you know, to 4,000 or 5,000 feet, you might want to lean it again and get another best power lean and lean again. So that way you're providing the best power. You can climb out as best you can at best power. So any other questions, comments, concerns? All righty. I think that's all I have for you guys. I'm mountain flying, so go out there and enjoy it, but stay cool and have fun.
Thank you, Josh.
I just wanted to make a comment about local operations.
Can you
come on up?
Sorry, Lord. Lord is our safety director here, and she's the one. Her and Fernanda in the back and the galley are the ones that run this, but go ahead.
Okay, so I just wanted to make a comment about operating out of here in the summers. And Gary referred to this last month, I think, when he talked about leaning. So you're pretty much going to either take off to the southwest, maybe the southeast if it's really early in the morning, but probably not directly east and not directly south. So I heard somebody report this morning they're departing southbound. And ATC will come back to you and they'll say, did you want southeast or southwest? Because they know we can't clear those mountains. So just be prepared that you're probably, your best bet is to go southwest. And Gary even said, and I agree with you, because I tried it the other day in the Remos at 5:30 a.m. or something and we cleared it. But I'm like, if it were any warmer than this, we would be going out to the southwest. So if you have to go southwest along the I-15 and then to gain some altitude and then cross over the mountains to go in the other direction, it may be a better idea. So, and then I also wanted to put a plug, the FAA is putting together these safety videos called Know Before You Go from the flight deck. They're doing one on Henderson. It's in production right now. I've seen some of the footage and it's really good, but they address some of these issues that we've been talking about tonight for like local operations. That's it.
And since you're up here, so I'm gonna stop this real quick. So Lauren and a few of our other members just recently raced in the Air Race Classic, and
yes.
I don't know if we're doing a safety seminar or anything on that in the future.
I was thinking about it. Yeah. Okay.
But give us like a 2-minute synopsis of how it went this last
week. Yeah. Oh man, it was really fun. So for those of you who don't know, the Air Race Classic is basically an air race that's been going on since 1929. It's changed names a couple of times. Because of the pandemic, they had to cancel it last year. And then this year they decided, because it takes so long to plan it, back in, you know, a year ago, they said, we're not sure whether we're going to be able to do the safety or not. So this year it was a derby. So instead of being a cross-country, literal 2,400-mile air race, this year it was a precision VFR planning derby. So we had three teams. There are women pilots, by the way, so a lot of 99s. Military pilots, airline pilots have done it before, and just, you know, recreational pilots. So the three teams from the club were myself and Glennis, who's a former student of mine, who's now a private pilot working on our instrument. I asked my daughter to do it, but she's a student at Embry-Riddle, and she said, I love you, but I really want to race for my school. So I said, okay, who wants to do it with me? So Glennis and I did it together, and then Gabby Thorpe is a retired KC-135 tanker pilot that got back into GA just recently. And then we also had Louise Bickerman, who is the principal harpist for the Utah Symphony Orchestra. I think that's right, Utah Symphony Orchestra. So very talented in her own musical realm, but also a wonderful commercial pilot. And then we also had one of our CFIs, Jennifer, fly the 172, and her co-pilot was Joanna, who was our admin person for a time. So three of us teams got together and we made some plans together, but then we started getting competitive. So we're like, okay, you guys plan your own thing. We'll see who wins. So we basically had to plan a route of 5 legs, and each leg was at least 65 nautical miles long. We had to take into account airspace, terrain. We had to land at one airport, and we had to estimate exactly how much time it would take us to fly from waypoint to waypoint, including the land airport, which was really tricky. Our team landed at Parker, Arizona. So we had, you know, stopwatches, and we flew a very precise pattern. Thankfully, nobody else was in the pattern at that time, so we got it down pretty good. So we don't find out until June 27th who actually won, because all the teams across, actually there's 4 countries represented. So all the teams have until June 26th to finish.
There's a 14 in North Vegas, right? So
there is the 4th Las Vegas team out of North Las Vegas. Yes. Yes. Yep.
They're all flying the same exact.
So Gabby's team and my team flew, but we both flew the Remoses. So we flew the same route, but we did it backwards. So we started southwest bound and they started southeast bound.
Yeah,
but we did it on different days.
Yeah, the other teams though, from like Embry-Riddle or the other 4 countries.
Everybody had got to pick their own route. Yep.
Oh, okay.
And then whoever completes it closest to their estimated time, they convert it into a percentage. And whoever comes closest to 100% accuracy is the overall. So we'll see. This is really different for all of us this year, even those of us who have done the actual air race before.
Yeah, just 1 second. 10 seconds.
Yeah, we'll see.
Maybe she was just saying it.
Maybe. I know. She was trying to get in my head, I think. Yep, so we'll see. But really wonderful experience. I feel like we are much more precise pilots. Even, I mean, I'm a CFI, but I was really trying to nail my altitude and my heading and my ground speed by controlling the throttle. So it really forces you to be very exact. So it was great. Yeah.
Who sponsors that? Is that OPA or?
So the Air Race Classic is its own organization. It's a nonprofit, but then each team is responsible for their own expenses.
Yeah. Surprise.
There is the usual Aries classes, it's a $5,000 reward.
Yep.
That really doesn't cover the whole the expense of flying in the race every year. Right. Kind of just offsets the cost. This year there are cash prizes. They're not as large this year, but I can't even remember what they are.
Well, cool. Thanks, Laura.
Yeah.
Thanks for filling us in.
They were on the news too, so which was great to get general aviation on the news. So it's definitely we've had a bunch of 99s meetings here, and it's been really cool seeing a lot of the female pilots come into the club. And Lauren's really driving that, so thank you, Lauren. Any other questions tonight about the club or anything else going on? I haven't looked to see if there's anything online here. Okay. So that's it. Thank you, everybody, for being here tonight. Again, safe flying. Keep those temperatures in line and enjoy the rest of your summer.
One other thing. Oh. If you didn't sign in, came in late or anything, make sure you sign in. Right.
Oh, and I'll mention that online, too. This is, does qualify for WINGS credits. And the easiest way to do it is make sure in that reminder email that went out today had the link for the WINGS. So it's easier if you go on there and register there. Please do that tonight so that you can get credit for it. And then if you're online or if you're here, fill out that sheet. We'll scan it in, or I'll just give it to you for now since you're here.
So. There's a pitch that they can please check.
Tell me when I'm on, I guess.
Yep.
Is that it? Oh, cool. Hey, so Fernando Molina, one of the CFIs, also a safety board member with Lauren and Alan. I'm also on the Las Vegas Fisto Fest team, so I get to actually input all of your WINGS credit. So if you could do me a favor and make sure that you logged into WINGS with the same email that you logged into Zoom. And if not, please let us know, because if not, it's really difficult to give you the credit, because the FAA only cares about what you're logged into the FAA safety.gov website. If you have any questions about that, email safety@desertflyingclub.com. And I'll be able to answer that question for you, but we definitely want to get you the WINGS credit. Remember, it helps you get to your annual faster, biannual, excuse me, faster credit for this stuff. So thanks.
All right, thank you. Just a couple more questions. I will throw this out there. Somebody asked if the old simulator is available to purchase, which is the old BATD. It's no longer authorized for recording in your logbook or flight training, but the owner is interested in selling it. So you can email, probably best to email me directly if you're interested, which is nathan@desertflying.club. And I can hook you up with the owner of that. So if you are interested, Thomas asked about it. That is available. It is working still, but it just no longer has an authorization certificate for training. And that's why we got the new sim. And I think that's it. Just going through the questions real quick. We will, we're continuing to try to figure out this hybrid environment. You know, we maybe next time we'll have a microphone for the speaker. I do have one in my office, so better mic the speaker up a little bit. Improve this every time. And our plan is to continue the hybrid, because we had 47 people on the hybrid side and about 18 here. So great attendance tonight. Again, thank you, everybody. Have a great night.
Thank you. Thank you, Judge.